Hi there, I'm Don Ross, and welcome to episode 2 of Guitar Case, my podcast about everything and anything to do with the world's most popular instrument, the guitar. I started playing the guitar at the age of 8, and it was a fertile time musically. I loved all sorts of music that I could get my hands on and my ears in front of. One instrument, though, tended to tie most of it together, whether it was funk or R&B or folk music or jazz or rock. The guitar was and continues to be everywhere. So if you love the guitar and guitar music, you've come to the right place. Now, I released episode 1 of this podcast way back in March of 2020, just as the COVID crisis hit. I thought for sure I'd have all kinds of time off the road to deal with making podcast episodes, but at the same time, I just started an online master's degree in orchestration, and the 16-hour days really got in the way of editing these shows together. Also, my wife Brooke Miller and I were shooting and editing videos for my new Don Ross Guitar Academy online lesson site, and, well, Guitar Case got placed on the back burner, unfortunately. Since graduating a few months ago, I'm pleased to report that I've been very busy writing new scores for video games and films. So the long work days haven't let up, but being in the studio all day means that I have the podcast as one of my open-ended projects staring in the corner mocking me all the time, beckoning me to put new episodes together. So at long last, here is part 2 of my in-depth interview with Rob Poland. Rob is the founder of CandyRat Records, a label that he started in 2005 as an internet-based way of marketing guitar music. In our first episode, we talked about what led Rob to found CandyRat. At this point in the conversation, we talk about early releases and the signing of important artists like Antoine Dufour, Andy McKee, Eric Turnbull, and others, as well as the explosive growth of fingerstyle guitar in the latter 2000s, thanks to the then-new phenomenon of YouTube. So you might want to go back and check the podcast's first episode or listen to it again, since it's been a while. I spoke with Rob in the late summer of 2019 at the Fingerstyle Collective Guitar Festival in Arkansas. It was 100 degrees Fahrenheit outside, and we were in a room with noisy air conditioning. Now, I've done some studio wizardry to remove a lot of the noise, but excuse the relatively lo-fi quality of the interview. So anyway, let's get on with it. Here's part 2 of my 3-part interview with CandyRat Records founder, Rob Poland. So at first, you were selling primarily, you were hoping people that would buy, people would order CDs online. And you also, I remember you and I having the chat about iTunes. And I know at first you were a little worried that you were going to be giving away too much. Mm-hmm. And I understand that because the iTunes model has always been that Apple takes 30% off the top. And then
the distributor takes an additional 15%.
Yeah. So you're maybe making, 50-ish percent of whatever comes in. What I talked to you about, though, was the glory of it was the not having to manufacture anything.
Right.
It's just data that people are actually paying for. And isn't that amazing,
Right.
A sale's a sale. So, I mean, even if you had to sell twice as many downloads or 3 times as many downloads as a physical product, who cares that you didn't have to manufacture anything? Isn't that great? So I think we had that chat and you agreed it was a good idea. And then everything was available on iTunes as well. So, but you also set up the CandyRat store to sell downloads directly, which of course would be better financially for everyone.
Yeah. I mean, so over this next year, we had to build an online storefront. I knew digital downloads, was the future. I thought CDs were kind of on their way. I mean, even at that time, in 2005, CDs were on their way down.
Definitely.
Digital downloads were on the way up. And so, the question is, do you want to give half your money to, iTunes and digital distribution, or do you want to go direct to the customers? Mm-hmm. And I bet on direct to the customers. What ended up happening is we did that first, and then we went to iTunes, so it was kind of a staggered or tiered release. We built the store, and I thought, okay, we had to build a custom cart. They didn't have carts back then with like digital downloads and stuff like that. I spent like over $10,000 building the technology, the code to actually do that stuff.
A lot of work, yeah.
It didn't exist back then.
Wow.
But I came, where I was working, we had a curriculum and technology department and it was all IT and coders and stuff like that. So I just hired my buddies to do that.
Nice.
So we built that thing and then I started thinking, okay, I'm going to have one CD on the store.
Yeah, right.
That's a weird store. You're going to give you a choice of one.
Choice of one, yeah, that's right.
I better sign some other music on there, you know, and let's have some, you know, I thought, okay, well, what should I put on there? And what I did was over the next year, I looked for artists that I could also sell in the store that was like similar type music. I found, I think there was a guy named Jack West Encourager, which had some cool fingerstyle jazzy stuff.
And didn't you start showing up at the Canadian Guitar Festival? And
well, that was the big event. Yeah. Right. That summer, I was on the Don's forum, and I noticed that they were talking about this thing called the Canadian Guitar Festival and a competition. I see Don talking with some of the artists. I didn't realize it at the time, but this was the fingerstyle community,
right?
That was on Don's Gobi Fish Yahoo board or something,
right?
Like
that's
that.
Right.
And so I said, you know what? I really got to get up to this Canadian Guitar Festival. I said, Don, I think I need to sign some other artists because we need more. This store and this label needs more choices.
Right, and I can't really remember the chronology, but I remember you coming up to the festival and expressing interest in some of the artists there. Plus, I had met Andy McKee at the Guitar Festival. He competed one year. And, he'd gotten in touch with me when he was quite young. He was like in his early 20s. And he sent me a couple of CDs, and I thought, geez, he's really good. But, it's a little rough around the edges still. Give him another couple of years. And then, sure enough, he competed at the Guitar Festival. I don't remember what year it was. I think it was 04 or something. And
got second place.
Yeah, I was one of the judges. And, of course,
that was the first year.
Oh, okay, that was the first year?
Yeah.
And I remember the way that we did the judging was similar to the way they do it in Winfield, where the other sort of big guitar competition that was around then, where the judges are performers at the festival and we're sequestered basically in this trailer. And so we have a monitor speaker hooked up to the PA that gets brought in, and they just give us a lot of coffee and water and all that kind of stuff. And we snacks, and we sit back there and we listen to hours and hours and hours of people competing.
Contestant number one.
Exactly. That's all you have is the number. And Andy played, I didn't know it was Andy. And the first thing he played was a tune called Art of Motion. And I went ballistic up in my brain anyway. I was just like, holy smokes, what a cool groove, you know? I just loved it. So great. And then and he followed up with another great song, and it's funny, he got into the finals, and then when we had to make a decision, 1, 2, 3, first place, second place, third place, I was like, hands down, Andy's one. I didn't know it was Andy, but I said contestant number 14 or whatever, absolutely. And the other guys were like, yeah, you know, he was good, or she was good, or whatever, but contestant number 21 really did it for me. And another person said, oh, I really like 37, you know. It's just like, really? I think, wow, that's not funny. I guess I don't know what I'm hearing that they're not hearing, whatever.
Robert Taylor won that year.
That's right, Robert Taylor. We've all voted and tallied up our things, and I added up the scores, and sure enough, my favorite was finishing second. I figured, oh, well, you know, that's the way it goes. That's fine. I'm just one of four judges. And then everybody got to play a little encore tune. And then we, you know, they said, please welcome their second place winner, Andy McKee from Topeka, Kansas. And I went, oh, that's Andy. Okay. He's written to me before. Cool. Oh, and he did that cool song. And then he decided as his encore tune, he'd play Tight Trite Night, one of my pieces. And I loved his take on it. It was so different from mine, and it was so cool. And when he finished it, the crowd went nuts, and I yelled out, do you have tab for that? And so that was cool, and that sort of started an association with Andy for me. I started hiring him to play at my guitar weekend and teach at them, and he'd open the shows and stuff like that. And then he came and opened on a tour, I think, at one point. And then, funnily enough, I think I suggested to you after you, you know, you signed people like Robert and a few other people.
I signed Robert first, right. And you told me you really need to check out Andy McKee.
Right, that's right.
And Andy McKee's the guy.
Yeah.
And then this was before the festival. I went up to the festival. It's in like August of, and we're opening up in November. And
right.
So I had Don and I had Robert Taylor.
Right.
And then that year, that was the following year, it was, let's see, Eric Turnbull won first place.
That's right, that's right.
Antoine Dufour,
yes,
got second place.
Yes.
And Andy got third place.
Oh my gosh, right.
So he went down a notch. And I think after that, Andy's like, okay, this is going in the wrong direction. I'm done with competitions.
Right, right.
And what I ended up doing is signing all of them.
Right.
And Robert Taylor had recorded a record that and it was ready to go. Eric Turnbull had no idea how to record, but he told me he had some songs.
Mm-hmm.
He was an amazing player, so I sent them down to record with Robert. Robert Taylor recorded Eric's record. And Andy had a couple records out, but he wasn't close to ready for his next record.
Mm-hmm.
And we had 4 months before your opening. And I thought, well, I really want to make a splash, you know, with really get some new music out there. And I said, well, maybe what we could do is take some songs off your first record and some songs off your second record. And hopefully you got some new songs we could put on it. And he thought that was a good idea.
Mm-hmm.
And I picked the songs and he agreed. And he sent me like the four songs, new songs, like a month later, and it was Rylan,
mm-hmm.
For My Father,
right.
Nakagawa-san,
right.
And I can't remember. Oh, actually, he had six. He had Dependent Arising, mm-hmm. But I think that one ended up going on the next one. There was one other
like
new
all
tune.
All Laid Back and stuff, or a tune like that? Or
I can't remember the fourth tune, but it was like the new tunes he sent me were like amazing.
Yeah.
I remember emailing and I was like, oh my God, you're right. Andy's amazing.
And I remember you sent me an advance.
I sent you like those MP3 files
that
you sent me on email. And
I remember,
Don's like, told you it's low.
Yeah. And I remember Brooke and I were having a nice meal and I said, well, let's give this a really close listen. And of course, my wife, Brooke, is a great guitar player as well. So we sat there kind of transfixed thinking, this is really something wonderful. So, you know, I felt really good. I felt sort of like vindicated, like I've got good taste, you know. And then here's a funny aside. The album came out, Art of Motion. And of course, like a lot of really great records, very few people noticed. So I thought, yeah, well, you know, that's kind of normal, you know, whatever. And so Andy was going to do something with me. At some point, I can't remember the chronology exactly, but I was on the road and he called me on my cell phone and I was on tour in New Brunswick, I remember, and New Brunswick, Canada. So he says, Don, I just got a royalty statement from CandyRat. So what he saw was that, you know, there were these costs to put his record out, but he'd only sold a very small number of records. And he said, geez, you know, it's like a few thousand bucks that I'm kind of down. What does that mean? And I said, well, that's okay. You know, it just means that your royalty account needs to have something in it eventually. And if you sell some records, and he says, well, how am I going to sell records? I said, well, there's this thing called YouTube. You know, I've got some stuff on there. It's brand new. And, you know, you should make some YouTube videos. And then eventually there was another tour booked. I don't remember who booked this one, but it was Michael Manring and me. Touring again through Canada and the Midwestern states, and Andy was the opening act, and so we played Toronto and we played Montreal and we played a few places, and I guess, did you book a bunch of those shows as well?
Yeah, I remember that story a little bit different.
Oh, okay. Okay, correct me, because my memory's fuzzy.
I remember making a DVD player, a DVD at University of Wisconsin,
yes.
And the audio turning out so bad.
That's it.
That was uncomfortable selling it.
That's right. Yeah, we're supposed to make it as a disc. That's
yeah,
right.
And you know, here's the thing. It's like we had gone almost a year after opening, and my previous company was paying my salary as like a 1-year exit clause.
Gotcha.
And I had a limited budget to get this business going. At the end of the And it was we put $150,000 to get this business going. And we had gone through about $120,000 after at the end of the first year. And at the end of that first year, we had $30,000 in sales. And so like when you make a record, like Andy gave me, you know, this music, and we go and we paid for mastering and to get it remastered so it all sounds the same. And we make CDs, and so that, you know, those are costs, and
of course,
you know, you have to recoup those costs before you make profit.
Sure.
And the record labels are 50 profit splits.
And just like when you're an individual artist, you know, you even if you make your own record independently, you have upfront costs, and you're trying to recoup those just like anybody else.
So the YouTube thing, again, $30,000 sales, we had put 120 in, and I had taken out no income because I had my previous, you know. So at the end of year one, I'm thinking, you know what, this is going to be a hobby for me. This isn't going to be a business. And that said, you know, I was committed to it. And I also knew it was a visual thing. You had to see it.
Yeah.
And YouTube was exploding at that time.
That's right.
And when the DVD thing failed, I had one video up there. I put Pino's up there because I was talking to Pino. I'd met
Pino
him.
Forestieri, right?
Pino Forestieri was, yeah.
Italian guitarist.
And we put up the DVD, the failed DVD attempt, we put up on YouTube for
Yeah, time. I remember you talked about it with me, and you know, I saw the results, and there was this big audio problem. I was very surprised, and I didn't know why it happened, because it seems to me it was that there was a big buzz on one of the microphones, and it wasn't caught at the time. And so when I listened back, I thought, no, I can't live with that much ground hum on the audio, not for a DVD. And I remember we talked to a mastering engineer that had worked for Narada, but was independent at this point. He was also in Milwaukee, and Trevor Sadler's his name, and he tried to fix it. But it ended up sounding like real audio, you know, like, you know, sort of underwater.
Terrible.
Yeah, it was really awful.
And they're still on YouTube today if you want to go listen to them, so, like how terrible that audio is.
But the funny thing is, you and I were talking about it. And of course, back then, YouTube, the quality overall of both the video and the audio, it was really not high definition at all. And there was no stereo and all that kind of stuff. So in the end, the fact that the audio didn't really work out, but then it was phased together in mono, was passable for online. So I remember you saying to me, okay, there's no way, obviously, it's good enough for DVD, but it's maybe good enough for the internet. Maybe good enough for this YouTube thing. And then you said, I remember, how do you feel about that? Like, if we put these up basically for free,
What do we have to lose?
Yeah,
we've already spent
exactly.
the $4,000 or $5,000 to hire the television studio.
That's right.
To mix this entire DVD with editing.
Yeah.
To get the audio mastered, all this stuff. We spent $5,000 and the audio sucked.
And then you said, well, look, we may have sold a few thousand copies if we put out DVDs, but this way, maybe, you know, with this new platform on YouTube, maybe you'll get 200,000 views of a song or whatever. And that's 200,000 people who, and a lot of those will probably be new fans. And I thought, well, yeah, that's
what
a great
do we
idea.
Have to lose?
Exactly. It's like free advertising.
And we put those up and they didn't do much.
No.
You know, and no surprise, because I mean the audio sucks so bad. I was 100% sold on YouTube. I got on the phone with Antoine and said, Antoine, can I fly you down to shoot some videos? And so after that DVD attempt, even though Don's wasn't taking off and those were our first YouTube videos, I was 100% convinced that we needed to visually get this thing out there.
Yep.
I flew Antoine down. We shot videos for his first record. He also delivered his second record because he had actually Nissan's ready when I first met him. So he had released Development right away, and we shot videos for Nissan's and Development. We put those up there. And Don had told me, I knew nothing about how to make videos. I knew nothing how to record audio, but the audio for the DVD turned out so poorly. I said to myself, I'm gonna learn how to do this myself.
Right.
Don knows how to record records. I called him. He taught me how to record. You get a microphone, you get a preamp, you got to get some software on the computer like Pro Tools. You know, so it's really like three parts, and from there you can kind of trial and error it. So anyway, I figured it out. Those weren't great recordings, but we recorded Antoine's videos. We put those up there, and Antoine's sales went from about 10 records a month to about, let's say, 50 records a month or downloads or whatever.
Sure.
And it was a significant increase.
It was an incremental thing. You could see it.
And then what I remember as far as this YouTube evolution thing was, we set up a tour. CandyRat set up a promotional tour that I was trying to, you know, push this music with Michael Mannering, Don Ross, and Andy McKee.
That's right.
You had set up some you had added some Canadian dates on the front of that.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember I picked you guys up in London, Ontario, or I met up with you. And
that's
then,
right.
And then we went through, you know, to do the shows in the States. And I remember us sitting down at dinner when we got to Milwaukee, and we were all talking about this YouTube thing. And the way I remember that conversation going was you weren't convinced at that time that YouTube mm-hmm. was going to be. You're like, well, I don't really see any impact from the videos that sure. we put up. And I said, well, you know, we put Antoine's up with better audio, and things are starting to move. So right. I'm convinced that this is it.
Mm-hmm.
So I offered to, you know, I had this home studio from doing Antoine, so mm-hmm. I'd done it once, you know, based on what you told me how
and
to
we
do
had
it.
A, and we had a day off on the road.
And we had a day off, mm-hmm. and I said, if you guys want to come over and shoot some videos, that would be great. We can try them on you. And I offered to do it for Michael Mannering. He took a pass. You said you're going to wait and see. You didn't mm-hmm. want to redo the audio.
Mm-hmm.
And then Andy's like, all right, well, you know, again, what do I have to lose?
Exactly.
Andy came over and shot those 8 videos mm-hmm. that went viral that one night, you mm-hmm. know, in like 3 hours.
And it was amazing.
That's how I remember that.
I remember. That yeah, I remember they got uploaded onto YouTube. And of course, they were there. And at first, you know, whatever, some views.
Mm-hmm.
And then my recollection was, this is like in December, I guess, of 2006. And I'm in my dining room doing some work on my laptop. And my daughter, who at the time, she's, I don't know, I'm just doing the math in my head. She was about 14 at the time. I just hear her scream from the top of the stairs, "Daddy, Andy's videos are on the front page of YouTube." Now, at the time, YouTube only featured a very small number of videos on its front page. And the crazy thing is that within like 24 hours, it seemed, Andy was on the front page of YouTube, the front page of Yahoo, and the front page of Reddit.
Right.
Like all at once.
And that started with Dig. It actually
started with Dig, not Reddit.
Pre-Reddit. Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, and the cool thing about YouTube and the whole timing of this thing was that back then, you know, YouTube was a year old.
Mm-hmm.
And if you got featured on the front page, what they would do is every few hours they would feature a new video.
Mm-hmm.
And the video that was featured a few hours before that would move down the page.
That's
so they
right.
would keep adding so it was like he was on the front page of YouTube for a week.
That's right.
Now the significance of that was back then there was one front page for YouTube.
That's right.
Today,
For the whole world.
Yeah. And it was blowing up. And today, every country has its own customized homepage, and really, probably every user now has its
yeah,
own customized
algorithms.
Front page based on their history.
Well, I believe that because every time I open YouTube, it's got to do with what I've just been watching.
Right.
Know?
So
yeah.
So we basically got millions of dollars mm-hmm. of free advertising
right.
to have that timing with those videos right there, because it was like the week before Christmas.
That's right.
And within 1 week, it got 1 million views.
Yeah, crazy. I remember, too, that, of course, the song we're talking about is Drifting. Duh. If you're not familiar with Andy McKee's song, Drifting, check it out. It's been on YouTube since 2006. I think it has over 100 million views now, or something insane like that, for a solo guitar record. What I told Andy after it blew up, I said, it looks like you're going to have the biggest solo guitar single since Classical Gas, and you'll do it without radio, you know, you'll do it with no radio play at all. And that's pretty much exactly what happened. So Andy went from being a guitar teacher in Topeka, Kansas, to suddenly having almost limitless touring possibilities. And then I don't know what kind of sales he was doing, but I remember it was insane for a little while.
Well, yeah, let me tell you about sales, because at that time I was interviewing for jobs, because I realized this was going to be a hobby, not a
right.
business. I had 3 interviews lined up, and Andy and I, you know, none of us knew what this meant really at the time. I remember Andy calling me and telling me, dude, I'm on the front page of YouTube. And I had a vision like of YouTube of like this happening. And I thought it could take 2 or 3, but if we stayed at it, it might happen. You know what I mean? And that could change things. And it happened. It happened within like months. It was like crazy. Such lucky timing. And I jumped. I was just jumping up for joy and screaming on the phone. And but we didn't know what it. We really didn't know what it meant. Sales. There's a lag in sales. So being a label and an artist, what the way it gets paid is like January through March sales gets paid in April, mid-April, 45 days after the quarter ends.
Right.
And so here's the thing. It hits the week before Christmas. For the next 45 days, all I did was pack CDs and ship CDs and monitor the comments on this video.
Funny, yeah.
Okay, I mean, like just... And I was up, you know, these are 15, 16-hour days.
Amazing.
It was so exciting, right?
Yeah.
Like, I realized the significance of the event. But I would go to the post office with a huge box of CDs. And CDs were done back then. You know, CDs were on the way to the client. But I would go to the post office with 100 CDs, and I would come back, and there would be 30 orders.
Yeah.
In the hour I was gone to the post office. So that, and his first, I remember sending Andy, like, I was like, Andy, those, you know, sales are great, right? And his next royalty report after that YouTube event, my understanding is he quit teaching the next day.
Right.
You know, I mean, he was like, okay, I'm done. Because that next royalty check was more than he made the entire previous year.
Sure. Amazing. And that was just for one quarter.
That was one quarter. That was for 3 months. Yeah. It was a big one.
Yeah.
And, sales went from 30,000 that year to, I think we did almost $400,000 in sales.
That's amazing.
You know, as a label. Now, that wasn't all Andy's.
No, I know. But
that
still.
Wasn't all Andy's sales, because the beautiful thing about it was that event got people interested in Fingerstyle.
Exactly.
And CandyRat and Antoine Dufour. And where'd all this come from? Don Ross was the guy, you know. Well, so there was tremendous spillover effect.
And the lovely thing too, and to this day, but about the way YouTube worked, was that if you were watching a certain kind of video, then there'd be the related videos along the side. So Andy's meteoric success was good for the rest of us too, because if you like this, you'd like Antoine. If you like this, you'd like Robert. Oh, if you like this, you'd like Don. If you like this, you'd like Eric. So all of us were lining up behind the success of that, and all of us saw a growth in our sales.
And just, you know, growth in Fingerstyle and interest in this type of playing and this type of music. So
absolutely,
it was, you know, it was great timing. It was perfect timing. You know, there's been a few kind of other things that have happened since then, like, you know, then it was Facebook got, you know, big for a while. And then, you know, the last few years it's been Instagram got big for a while. So
it'll be something else in a year.
It'll be something else in a year or two. And, you know, it's original. The nice thing about that event was it was original music.
Yeah, exactly. You know? That was the best thing about it, really. It wasn't somebody doing a cover of a pop song. It was a guy just playing his own tune. And, you know, there was the sort of the grab me, the gotcha thing at the very beginning, where he was playing in an unorthodox way, reaching over the top of the guitar with his left hand, you know, and Andy fortunately is really good friends with Preston Reed, you know, and he was sort of saying, well, yeah, I wrote that tune when I was a teenager after going to a Preston Reed guitar workshop, and I wanted to write a tune kind of using some of that technique, and it was the only one he'd ever written like that, and that was so funny. And the song was like the better part of 10 years old by the time he put it on a recording or made that video.
And again, I remember not to toot my own horn, but, you know, I mean, I have had some good ideas. and I remember that was the last tune we recorded in that Andy McKee session. It was a very old tune at that point. I said, well, maybe we should do that tune because it's over the top and it's different. It's the Preston Reed style, you know. So let's make sure we get that one on video, because he wasn't, you know, I mean, that wasn't high up on his list of tunes at that point, because he just, For My Father, Violin, he'd written all these recent beautiful tunes. So, but we did that, you know, let's get that one for, you know, because potentially the marketing potential.
And I remember before the videos were made, there was, memory's a little fuzzy on this, but I remember being out at an event with you and your dad in Milwaukee, and Andy was there. and somebody else. There was another player or two. Anyway, while we were eating, Andy went up and played a few tunes for people, and I can't remember what the context was. And that was the first time I heard Drifting. And and I watched him and listened to him play.
Oh, you know, that was that you guys just went out to dinner, and
that's right.
You were probably playing for the owner of the restaurant.
That's right. That's right.
Because yeah, my dad was buddies with I think his name was Jim or something like that, and he owned the Riverside Inn in Mequon.
Okay. Okay. And your dad was saying, "Don, Don, you don't have to do this, but let's get Andy to play some songs." So Andy played a few tunes, and he played Drifting. And I thought to myself, "Well, that's visually compelling, and it's a snappy little tune that might be a tune that he does well with, you know." And I remember when we did live shows, I said, "Make sure you play that tune where you do the ding ding ding, because that's kind of a cool song." And he says, "Oh yeah, sure, why not?" So it's kind of funny for him at that point. It was a bit of a toss off tune, but you know, look what happened.
Yeah, that was the tune. And although Ryland did really well,
of course,
Ryland and. For my father, because Drifting, you know, drove traffic to those videos.
And he did one cover of that Toto song I did well as well.
You know, Africa.
Like, yeah, exactly. Yeah, Africa. So that was kind of really where things really got started for CandyRat in a big way. It was in the very beginning of the story, but it was certainly where things launched. And it's kind of amazing even to hear a lot of the details even I didn't know about what happened and what the repercussions were. And there you have it, at long last, episode 2 of my podcast, Guitar Case. Really sorry for the long wait. In fact, it was pretty funny. I was listening to episode 1 again just before finishing this edit, and it was pretty funny to hear me say at the end of episode 1 that I hope to have episode 2 up within a week or so. And that week only took me 18 months. So I promise that won't happen again. That was really silly. I'm going to get episode 3 of this. I won't say when, but it'll be really soon. It won't be 18 months, okay? It'll be in the next couple of weeks. And also, there's other stuff I've got to put together. Like, I've got a great interview with the guitar builder Mark Beneteau, who's made all my guitars for the last 24 years, as well as a whole pile of other people. I also have this other thing called the Don Ross Guitar Academy. So if you go to donrossguitaracademy.com, you'll see that right now we have the beginner level lessons up there. So what I've done is I've set up this teaching site, and the beginner level takes you right from the very beginning. What kind of guitar to buy, what kind of strings to use, how to tune the instrument, all that kind of stuff, all the way up to, over the course of about 37 short lessons, some basic fingerstyle and flat picking techniques. I'm in the middle of making the intermediate lessons now. They take a long time to edit, so hopefully those will be up very soon. So the cool thing is that if you join the DRGA, the Don Ross Guitar Academy, you can also join the private Facebook group that we have for members. And what I do there is every week I have a studio drop-in where people come from around the world and we talk shop. We talk about guitars and we talk about playing. We talk about traveling. We talk about tuning. We talk about techniques and things like that. I play some tunes as well. Also, once a month, we have a special guest. So far I've had special guests like Andy McKee, Caroline Langendijk, Callum Graham. The list goes on. All these great players. It's been about 6 or 7 interviews so far. So please join up if you're not already. It's just a simple thing. You go to that website and it's a monthly subscription thing. You can drop out whenever you want. But I'm going to repurpose some of the interviews we've done from there, put them up on the podcast and up on YouTube. They're really cool, in-depth interviews with really cool people in the guitar world. All right. So thanks for listening, and I hope to see you right here again real soon on Guitar Case.